episode 63, part 3 of Kenya's premier sports video podcast, the Three Quarters Podcast. As usual, we'd like to remind you to jump onto the hashtag Road to Japan to support our Kenya Simbas as they are still looking to qualify for the Rugby World Cup in 2019 in Japan.
The Three Quarters Podcast has hooked up with Odd Shaped Balls and Raga House to come up with a list of the guys we think should be rewarded for being the 2017-2018 player of the season. Therefore, head to the Odd Shaped Balls website to vote for the person who you think should be the 2017-2018 player of the season. I'm Naraka Muya.
I'm Dineema Duffy. Everything other than rugby. And we start off with the EPL wrap-up. Uh-huh. Now, today we talk about the 2017 and 2018. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's so much easier to say 2017-2018. Yeah. Yes, uh-huh. Season. And basically, top six clubs, yeah, and the pros and, yeah, the cons. Yeah. So our top six are Manchester City, mm-hmm, Manchester United, mm-hmm, Liverpool, Tottenham Hotspur, Chelsea, and Arsenal. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, yeah, I mean, quick first, because there's kind of a break this weekend because, yep, of the FA Cup this past weekend. So the only Premier League game that was worth noting was Liverpool versus Watford. 5 goals for Liverpool, 5-0, and Mohamed Salah, Mo Salah, Egyptian striker, getting 4 goals. So anyway, as you say, the table is now Man City, Manchester United, Liverpool, Tottenham, Chelsea, and Arsenal. Man City, Pep Guardiola, finally showing that he's class. There were questions when he joined the Premier League as to whether he was going to be able to deliver in what I think is the most competitive league in the world. He's delivered in Spain, he's delivered in Germany, but England is the most competitive, I think, in my opinion. And what happened in the first season is that he finished fourth or thereabout. But anyway, they've been able to lead for most of the season, and I think they're going to be the eventual winners. So Man City have had a very good season. Manchester United, they're recovering from a couple of bad years. They're recovering from a couple of bad years when Alex Ferguson left in 2012. So they had David Moyes, they had Louis van Gaal as coach. So Jose Mourinho has come in. And last season, not too good, but they're able to win the Europa League, and they're back in the Champions League and now finishing second. I think they're mounting what's going to be a very serious challenge next season. Liverpool coming back. I admire the way Liverpool play, because one thing that I like about Liverpool is they've not left the values of the club. Mm. I keep on saying that the three clubs in England that are all about traditions, and traditions are very important to the club, Arsenal, Liverpool, and Manchester United. Mm. And for that reason, I think that's why they're the most successful clubs in England. So Liverpool have not cheated the game, mm-hmm, and they've been able to rebuild over the last few years. And you're seeing a very formidable team, Sadio Mane, Firmino, Mo Salah, you know, Jordan Henderson, a very good team and a very solid team. So it's good to see them finish third, and I think they'll be able to capitalize. Another team that has not cheated the game, mm-hmm, is Tottenham Hotspurs. They've built, you know, Harry Kane, Son, Victor Wanyama. And them finishing fourth, it's a drop from last season, but Tottenham were always a mid-table team. To see them competing with the big boys, mm-hmm, and not having the amount of money the big boys have is very impressive. For a lover of sport, not the business of sport, the sport, mm-hmm, itself,
the actual sport,
you have to admire what Spurs are doing. Chelsea, Antonio Conte, I don't think is going to be lasting. Mm-hmm. They dropped. I mean, they're the ones who won the season last year. They are now number 5. Outside the Champions League position, and they've had a very dismal season, to be honest. So Chelsea, I don't think they have anything to write home about. Arsenal, I'm a supporter of Arsenal. Arsenal are having problems, but I'm liking what's happening in terms of the fans revolting and the fans not going to the stadiums, mm-hmm, because when it stops making financial sense for Stan Kroenke, mm-hmm, to keep Arsene Wenger, mm-hmm, that's when they're going to get rid of Arsene Wenger. Yeah. And I think this is the first time, I'm a big supporter of Arsene Wenger, but this is the first time I'm feeling that, yes, indeed, his time is done at Arsenal. So I think that's a wrap-up, and that's what has been largely in the 2017-2018 season. And I do feel that the top six are going to end the way it is.
You're making me think those are very smart fans. Like, they thought, you know, if we don't go, yeah, and then they don't make revenue,
yes,
and then this will happen, yeah, and then there'll be no coach,
yeah,
and then we'll get another coach.
Yeah.
That's very well thought out.
It's very well thought out, and I like what I'm seeing at Arsenal. I think that's what should be happening. I think, because Arsene Wenger makes financial sense. He makes business sense for the owners. He'll get you good results. You get the TV revenues. You'll get the gate charges up, because people hope that Arsenal are going to be winning, but it's not happened. We've not won the league in the last 13 years, 14 years. That's since 2004. It's a very long time. Liverpool is longer, but at least they're somewhere. So yeah, I think it's time. It's time Arsene Wenger left, and it's not making financial. When it stops making financial sense for Stan Kroenke, that's when he gets rid of Arsene Wenger.
Yep.
Yeah.
So we move on to golf, and the Kenya Open starts next week. That is the 22nd of March.
Yeah.
So basically, what has made it the best organized tournament, or annual tournament rather, in Kenya? I mean, they've got their sponsors. They're attracting, you know, fine golfers from around the world.
Yeah. So I mean, just a short history for our viewers. Started in 1967, the Kenya Open is played at Modaiga Country Club. Apart from couple of years, 1968, 2004, 2008, and 2013 to 2016, when it was at the Karen Country Club. So it's part of the European-based Challenge Tour since 1991. It's a, as you say, it's a professional golf tournament, and only professionals actually in Kenya pay. As we speak, 19 of 22 have qualified, you know, names like the veteran Jacob Okello.
I know that name. You know, I heard that name so long ago. I wish I knew he was a boxer, though. I mean, sorry, a golfer. Yes. A golfer. Oh, my word. Yes, a golfer.
Yes, so Jacob Okello is one of the people, one of the 19 guys who've qualified for the Kenya Open. A couple of other guys have the chance. I think the most notable name in that group is Richard Ainley from Nakuru. He's a left-handed, very powerful driver.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I think those are the guys who will be knowing the course of the week, whether they make it for the Kenya Open. But Kenya Open, it's been run very well. It's become a social function. You know, guys normally go there just for the social. They don't understand anything about golf, but they're there because it's the Kenya Open. And in the earlier, it used to be the Tusker Kenya Open. It's now some legislation passed a few years ago saying that alcohol cannot be the main target sponsor, so it's shifted to the Barclays Kenya Open. So yeah, it's going to be, if we did not have our engagement in the rugby circles, I think that's one of the things that I would definitely have wanted to go for, that is the Golf Open. So for our viewers and those people who watch golf, it's going to be happening from the 22nd of March to the 25th of March at Modaiga Country Club. Make your way to Modaiga Country Club. I'm sure it's going to be a cracker, and I'm sure it's going to be an excellent social event, even if you don't understand the golf.
From the sideline?
Yeah.
Like not literally.
Yes.
But you know, yeah.
Yeah.
So we also had the rally this weekend.
Yeah.
That was what, Friday, Saturday and Sunday?
And Sunday, yeah. The 2018 Safari Rally, by the way. It's a Safari Rally.
Yes.
So yeah, it has been held in the Naivasha and in the Great Rift Valley area, Aberdare. And it started on Friday, as you said, and ran up until Sunday. Carl Flash Tundo, navigated by his longtime partner, Tim Jessop, finishing on top, sponsored by Top Fry. Flash is always somebody very... He's thrilling to watch. When you go watch the rally and you see Flash, you're like, ugh! The adrenaline rush. So anyway, Carl Flash Tundo coming out on top. He's won it now for 5 times, and he's equaled the record set by Shaka Mehta. And for you to equal Shaka Mehta, Shaka Mehta was a guy in the 70s, very big rally guy, and that's when the Safari Rally was part of the WRC. So he's equaled that record. Number two court was Baldev Chaga, popularly known as Baldy, navigated by Ravi Soni. They were number two, and number three was Ugandan Jas Mangat. So Flash winning it for the 5th time, and I'm just waiting to hear what WRC, because WRC had sent a couple of their top dogs. FIA sent a couple of their top dogs. There was a marketing person for WRC, and there was a technical person from FIA, just to see how the safari is going to be run. So I'd like to listen to the reports that they give, because remember, we are trying to get back onto the WRC, to get the safari rally back onto the WRC.
Well, I hope they make it.
Yeah,
and I hope they're up to par.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, like I said, I will come along and I will watch. So now we move on to our bonus topic.
Yeah.
And it's basically, for the last 7 to 8 years, we've seen a decline in the attendance of some of the best sporting events.
Yeah.
That is your, you know, your Safari Sevens, your Safari Rally, your Great Rift, rather, Tennisside. Yes, Great Rift Tennisside. However, one tournament has continued to grow over the years in leaps and bounds, and that is the Barclays Open.
Yes.
Which, you know, we've just talked about.
Yes.
So question one is, what has Kenya Open done right?
Okay.
And then what is ailing the organization of these other tournaments? I mean, why are they not doing as well? You know, why is there such a dismal attendance? And question three is, what should be done to change this thing? Question two.
Yes. So yeah, I'll answer all at once and then we'll just be discussing. So anyway, the Kenya Open, what has the Kenya Open done right? I think the first thing is that they have the Kenya Golf Limited, which is a corporate organization, or it's a holding company that runs with the organization of the Kenya Open. And it has professionals who are running it, because some of the directors are guys who've been in corporate governance for a very long time. I think about Peter Kanyago, who's the chairman of Kenya Golf Limited. I think about Kathleen Kihanya, but for me the most important person and is a professional in terms of corporate governance, he sits on the board of Standard Chartered, is Patrick Obath. Patrick Obath is the tournament director, and I think he brings his expertise in the running and he runs it like a business. A lot of money has been put aside for marketing, because whenever the Kenya Open is happening, a month and a half before, all the media platforms have been flooded with Kenya Open stuff. So I think that's another thing that they're doing right. I think the masterstroke that the Kenya Golf Limited did was when they engaged former President Mwai Kibaki, who was a patron of the Kenya Golf Society, to come as a guest of honor, because he used to attend it as a guest of honor, and it has become a tradition. So President Uhuru Kenyatta comes into office, he becomes
a guest. Yes.
When the president is there, it increases the value of the competition, and therefore corporates want to associate with that, and the money is being put to good use. So that's also a big thing. I think that was a masterstroke. I also think the fact that they have a prize money, I think it's about $200,000. That prize money is very good, and it attracts the top guys.
That would attract me.
It would attract everyone. So what has been ailing these other things, I think it's mismanagement and lack of management. And I think about Safari Sevens, for example. This is the Safari Sevens Limited that used to run just through the organization, but it was disbanded some 5, 6, 7 years ago. And that's when our problem started with Safari Sevens. So it's just mismanagement. And I think everyone should be borrowing a leaf from the Kenya Golf Limited in the way you run international tournaments and in the way you run successful tournaments. So I believe that that's a blueprint if we want to move forward. That's a blueprint that we should be adopting, whether it's in rugby, whether it's in football, whether it's in the rally. We should be adopting the blueprint that the Kenya Golf Limited has set for the Kenya Open.
And just one thing, you know, using the Safari Sevens as a sort of example, and I'm not going to say, you know, who, I'm not going to name names, but we should move away from this thing where you say, you know, I know this person, so bring them in. Who is giving you the best? Yes. Who's got the best offer on the table?
I like what you say. And just before we wrap up, I remember, I'll give us during the World Under-18 Championships, IAAF, when Mwangi Mothe was appointed as the LOC chairman, there was a lot of noise from the athletic circles about Mwangi Mothe being appointed, because he's not an athlete, not a runner, a track and field. And they're like, oh, you can't ask me to go around the Safari Sevens. And Hassan Wario, who was a sports minister at that time, said something very brilliant. I'm not thinking about who he is, I'm thinking about service delivery. That's how we should be looking at it. I'm not looking at Damima because she's my friend. It's about service delivery. So yeah, I do agree with you.
Guys, do you agree? Remember, you can follow us on Instagram, like our page on Facebook, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.
And lastly, we inform you that the Three Quarters Podcast has partnered with Oddship Bowls and Raga House to come up with a list of people we think should be rewarded as a 2017-2018 Kenya Cup Player of the Year. Head to the Oddship Bowls website and vote for the person you think deserves to be the 2017-2018 Kenya Cup Player of the Year. I'm Ngaro Kamuya.
And I'm Demi Duffield. Also, there is a slot for people who to put in their own name.
Oh, yeah.
So yes, head on. Alright? And that's it for episode 63, yes?
Yeah.